take it slow, but it's not typical. He already knows that my love is fire. His heart was a stone, but then his hands were on. I turned him to gold and it took him higher. But I'll be a daydream, I'll be your favorite things. We could be beautiful, get drunk on the
everybody, how is everyone doing today? Good. It's 10 a.m. in San Francisco, 1 p.m. in New York, 5 p.m. in Ghana, West Africa, 7 p.m. in Paris, 10:30 p.m. in Mumbai, and 1 a.m. in Singapore. Wherever you are, whether it's your morning, afternoon, or late evening. It is my pleasure to welcome all of you to our Coffee Hours and its fifth edition of Portfolio Reviews. I'm your host, Trids Banerjee, and I advocate for 5,000 plus designers worldwide here at Amazing Design People List. If this is your first time joining us, we want to say thank you. Thank you for trusting us. Thank you for sharing your work on ADP List. And thank you for sharing your energy with all of us. Amazing Design People List is a community-initiated talent base, helping designers land new jobs and connect with over 500 design mentors globally. This is your community, for designers by designers. Yesterday, we all received the absolutely tragic news coming out of Beirut. Last night, people in Beirut slept in shattered homes during a deadly pandemic, with a collapsing economy led by corrupt politicians, surrounded by countries that have attacked and threatened them, and a world that has abandoned them and their refugees. They deserve better. If you are looking for how to help them, some of the most trustworthy ways are by downloading the Lebanese Red Cross app or donating to Impact Lebanon's Disaster Relief Fund. Here at ADP List, we are thinking of everyone who has been injured and all those who are trying to locate a friend or family member or have lost a loved one. We are keeping you in our thoughts and we stand ready to assist in any way we can. Today, we are joined by three amazing design mentors who are going to review your portfolios in a round-robin style. So if you wish to have your portfolio reviewed, please submit your portfolio link on the Zoom chat. The mentors will randomly pick a link from the chat below and provide critiques live in less than 10 minutes, almost like simulating the real environment of a recruiter reviewing portfolios. It is our hope that you are able to notice what stands out in your case studies and where you need a little extra fuel. The mentors here will try their best to provide you with some actionable feedback. But before I introduce our dearest design mentors to you, I want all of you to think about what is a good design. Let us all take a moment to think about a time when we saw something in the real world or online, when we experienced something, and then almost instantly we all smiled and said, "Wow, that's a freaking good design and I love it." Aesthetically speaking, good design does not use all capitals for every word. It does not single out a word as a widow on a line. In fact, it adjusts spacing and leading between lines. But what about strategic and technical design? So I would ask you again, what is good design? Now, I understand that good is a very subjective term, but I think we can all agree that good design is innovative. Good design makes a product useful and understandable. Good design is unobtrusive, is honest, is long-lasting, is environmentally friendly, and finally, good design is accessible by everyone. So did you take these into consideration while building your own portfolios? Our mentors are the best judge of that. So please welcome our first mentor, Lily Connings. Originally from New York, Lily is a product designer from Facebook, based in San Francisco. Prior to Facebook, Lily was at AngelList, IBM Watson Health, and a handful of startups. So Lily, welcome and tell us what you do at Facebook and perhaps share with us a fun fact about yourself.
Sure. Hi, everybody. Good morning from where I am. Good evening to the rest of you. I am currently on the Messenger team at Facebook, but I actually do work across Messenger and Instagram because there is a messaging experience in Instagram as well. I'm sure you all know what a DM is. So that's why I'm working on Facebook. A fun fact about me is I recently bought something called a summer board, which is if you imagine an electric motorized skateboard with bindings that ride like a snowboard, that's exactly what it is. It has two omnidirectional wheels in the center that allows you to carve. And so I'm extremely excited to get back on it whenever work is done.
That's amazing. Thanks, Lily, and welcome once again. Next up, we have Nicolas Backhill. Born and raised in Mexico City, Nicolas is the team lead and staff product designer at Okta. He has worked on some amazing projects, such as the Human Diagnosis Project. Nicolas, welcome to our club, and please share with us what you do at Okta and where you are located right now. And I'm not letting you go away without sharing a fun fact about yourself.
Thank you, Trace. Thanks, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here and to see you all. As Trace was mentioning, I was born in Mexico City and moved to the Bay Area, actually for a fun fact. I have a background in architecture, so I went to architecture school, and that's what got me to the Bay Area originally. And then after working in the architecture field for a few years, I decided to transition into product design. That's where I am today. What I do at Okta, I'm the lead product designer for our end user experiences, which means that anything that end users touches when they use Okta, that's what we work on. And it's been an amazing journey so far.
Amazing. Well, welcome again, Nicolas. And finally, we have Farai Medzima. Farai is the current UX lead at Shopify based out of Ottawa in Canada. Born in Zimbabwe and originally going to be a doctor, Farai spent the last 14 years designing products in the UK, South Africa, and Canada. Farai, welcome. Please tell us, what are you currently building at Shopify? And something fun, maybe?
All right, cool. Peace. Glad to meet y'all. Thank you for making the time. Trids and friends, thank you for setting up this awesome community to help folks level up and, you know, to open the door to more designers around the world. So I'm originally born in Zimbabwe. So fun fact, I'll start with the fun fact. I was actually going to be a pediatrician. After I did my high school, I applied to 4 universities in the UK. I didn't get the grades. I failed. 4 universities turned me down. And the only other course I could do was the one that taught me human computer interaction. So becoming a designer is the best decision I never made. I just kind of fell into it. But nevertheless, I find myself in Ottawa in Canada at Shopify. I'm in a massive UX team. There's like 500 peeps in it. So I'm one of many UX leads here. And I work in an area where we are working on inventory. And so what we are trying to do is to help people who are opening their e-commerce businesses to be able to count all the things that are in their stores that they want to be able to sell. And that's me.
Amazing. Well, thanks to all of you for joining us. Once again, if you wish to have your portfolios reviewed, please share your portfolios links on the chat below. We will have the last 5 minutes for an open Q&A with the mentors. So if you have a question, please hold on to them until the very end. For any reason, if you get disconnected from the Zoom call, please try joining back or visit our YouTube channel. We are currently simulcasting live on YouTube. All right then, Lily, Nicolas, Farai, the floor is all yours. Go for it.
All right, I am up first, and I took a chance to pick one already. I'm gonna share my screen. There we go. Can everybody give me a thumbs up if you can see my screen? Awesome, cool. So I have decided to select Sophie's portfolio. I think that before I actually start examining this portfolio, one disclaimer that I will give to, I think that might be helpful for everybody in general, is that the way that your portfolio is evaluated, you're evaluated by 2 types of people, either a recruiter or a hiring manager. And I come from the perspective of a hiring manager, which means that I tend to spend a little bit more time on your portfolio and I look for details. I really read into the exact decision-making that you took in each of your projects. I really look at the little details of your mocks. Whereas on the other hand, a recruiter is a little bit more high level. Right? They're kind of looking for general criteria that they're looking for to match a certain job. And so if it seems like I've glazed over any pieces that you thought, you know, I should have looked at, or if it seemed like I took too little time, be mindful that a recruiter will actually take even less time and be even less likely to hone into those details. So one great thing for you to be able to do is, you know, if I missed a detail, make that detail bigger. If you truly believe it was important, like make that detail even easier for me to see at a glance. So I think that's just a general takeaway and a good to know as I start approaching these. So Sophie's portfolio looks awesome so far. I think that it's amazing that she has some key details already for me without me scrolling or interacting with everything. It's important for me to know that she's San Francisco based, so I know exactly her locale. And then just to reconfirm that she is a product designer, I love that. I also appreciate that the thumbnails into her projects are the actual product shots. A lot of people sometimes include, you know, the logo of the company that they worked for or even a stock photo, and those are not indicative of the type of project I'm about to examine. I really need to know the type of signals before I really dedicate myself to start reading your case study. So for example, coming from Facebook, I especially am looking for designers with mobile experience, and the fact that Sophie has a bunch of mobile experience already makes me even more inclined to learn more about her. So clicking into the first study, I really appreciate that she has a header into exactly what the project is, again, confirming that it's a mobile app, and then a little bit of a longer problem statement, overview of the project. I think that's amazing. I appreciate that she's confirming her role in the project, but I would have loved actually even beyond that, the makeup of the team overall. I know that projects sometimes can be a solo thing, but if this isn't a solo thing, I want to know that there were other hands on the project and know that I have to then later ask you down the interview pipeline, like what was the exact contribution you made to this project and kind of suss that out. And then I appreciate that she's putting the process here. However, I will say that it's on the less important spectrum of things for me to know right now. I think that if you are going to put a couple bullet points of the project overview at the beginning, which is something that you should always be doing, process was probably one of the lowest on that on the list of things that you could include, just because process is relatively common and basic across all types of product design roles at this point. Every product designer is researching, defining, ideating, designing, prototyping, testing, and iterating. And so that doesn't give me any extra information about you. I think that the type of information I would have appreciated, again, the team makeup, maybe the timeline for this project. So did this take place in 2020? You know, was it three-month project? Was it a year project? Those are definitely very different types of projects to assess. You know, what is the status of this project now? Did it ship, or was it a student project? Did it not ship due to some other reason? So on and so forth. Like, those details are what I want to know. I really appreciate the fact that she's including, again, her product shots at the beginning here. I don't have to scroll very far to kind of get this zoomed in look into what the product does. A picture really does say 1,000 words. I'm much more likely to learn about what the app does rather than read, you know, everything here. So it looks like this is something having to do with health. It looks like it requires some sort of user input. It tracks progress over time. Awesome, all fairly complex interaction patterns. So I'm more intrigued to read more about this. So it looks like there's some competitive research here. That's great. I also appreciate that she bolded the important insight here. That's really, really great. That's awesome. So I think that out of research, really the only thing that I will want to know about at this point is the actual insight. And I think she did a great job here. She pulled out a couple of important quotes for me and then gave me a goal. I will say this goal's a little bit on the ambiguous side. It doesn't really tell me exactly how this insight is derived from her research. I would love to have had something a little bit more grounded here, but I do appreciate, at least for the storytelling aspect, this is doing a great job.
Can I add something about the research piece?
Of course.
So really briefly, I was going to say, I really appreciate having like the screenshot on the left that highlights the different companies and people's reactions to them, I assume. That being said, if I was going through a portfolio and actually wanted to know more, I would expect to be able to either see this bigger or have a summary somewhere. Why I'm saying this is not readable. So I would appreciate if anything that you put in your portfolio, if there's there, is there for a reason? And if you want me to read it or anyone to read it, make sure that it's readable.
Totally agree. That's a great point. All right. I think I want to move on a little bit quicker because I probably have spent the first three of my 5 minutes already. I'm going through, I understand this is process, more process work. Persona is something that's interesting. I could have an entire talk about it, but it's nice to see that you're following pretty standard design thinking process here, some content strategy. This is slightly difficult to read if it is right aligned, but that's a super nitpicky thing to say. Content map, this is great. A little bit of information architecture, a little bit of branding work here, great. Let's see, design and test. So I'm assuming these are mid-fi to high-fi prototypes that you have shown here, which are then compiled into the final prototype here. And I really, really do appreciate that you're including a video showing the actual workflow through the final product that you've designed. I really do appreciate this a lot. I also like that you've basically linked here in case I do want to interact with it myself. So I think this shows off a little bit of your visual design, a little bit of your motion design, even interaction design, of course. And I think that's great. And then results. Again, I think indexing a little bit on readability here would be important, just like Nicolas mentioned. It's a little bit hard for me to parse out exactly what the most important key metrics are. Key metrics are something that is incredibly important to have for something that is already launched. So, did you hone on just qualitative usability studies to see if this was a successful design? Did you launch it? And then there were engagement metrics that you were looking at to make sure that this was useful to people. I would love to learn a bit more about that and to basically get confirmation that the work you did was impactful. And then I know that my time is probably up, but I think final thing here is that I don't think there was enough iteration. I don't think there was enough iteration across the designs that you've done. What you've done is really shown me the breadth of all the key screens that you designed, which is great, but I don't see any iteration between, say, one to two of the most important workflows that you've designed for. I think it's really important for me to see that process over, you know, some of the more, research, persona, content strategy, that those processes, depending on the company that you go to, you know, can be outsourced to a different role. And so content strategist, for example, is an explicit role. User researcher is an explicit role. So those typically I call to be bordering competencies that are excellent if you're great at, but the core competency that you have to prove here is that you're good at design. And I'm not seeing proof of that through some sort of iteration of the design that you're proposing. So I think that would have been really great to have. And with that, I'm going to give time to the other mentors. I think Nicolas, you're up.
Yes. Thank you, Lily. That was awesome. Okay, everyone. So I'm going to do something really similar. I'm just going to pick someone from the chat and open your portfolio. And I'm going to share my screen. Here we go. So thumbs up, you can see my screen. Yes, great. Okay, so I opened Thomas' portfolio. So I'm just gonna do something pretty similar to Lily just did. Just gonna go through it as I was looking for to hire someone from a company and just give you feedback. Just to add a couple of intro points to what Lily was saying, well, I totally agree with her that there's two types of people that are going to be looking at your portfolio, recruiters and design managers. And the time they're going to spend on it is a little bit different. But generally speaking, people are going to go through your portfolio pretty quickly. So you just want to make sure that the story you're trying to tell is pretty clear and it can be conveyed really easy without having to spend too much time on it. And then the other thing I'll add before I start going through Thomas' portfolio is that you should always tailor your portfolio towards their, assuming you're using your portfolio to get a job somewhere, you should tailor your portfolio towards that role or towards what you're looking for. And the reason why I'm saying this is I've seen portfolios that designers talk about UX, UI, visual design, research, and architecture, my past experience, everything at the same time. And sometimes where you're looking for someone, it's amazing that, but I love to see that you're a pretty like broad designer. You have so many things, but at the same time, it's good to focus what the company, what the role you're looking for, and make sure you can convey that part as well. So right off the bat, Thomas' portfolio looks pretty clean. I appreciate that you started with a sentence about who you are, what you do, what's your experience. So full stack developer and turned to product design, that's pretty cool. That's awesome. Talks about your strong background and understanding how things are being built. 3 years of experience, take a background, clear communication, we'll see about that, and visual design, awesome. So that's a good intro. A couple other things that I'm noticing here is you have projects at top, resume, and about me. My assumption is resume is just a PDF of your resume, and about me is an about me page. We'll see about it in a sec. In my opinion, these two are kind of doing the same thing. They're just talking about who you are and the specific about your experience, your previous experience. So I don't know if you need 2 links here, maybe just having one about me. And then inside, if someone wants to actually download a PDF, you can do it there as well. Just thinking about ideas of how you can clean your portfolio and have less confusion for anyone looking through it. So I'm gonna scroll and look at your project. So I can see here, you're a UX and UI designer, a large automotive company, it's pretty cool. And then you have 2 case studies here. And then here's some other projects. So one thing I'll say, and in this case, I don't think it's a problem, but a lot of people have too many projects. And the reality is that most recruiters or design managers are gonna go through a portfolio are gonna see the first project, hopefully a second, and then if a miracle happened, the third. Usually they'll get a pretty good sense about who you are and your capabilities and your background with the first project. And if they see something that they don't like, they're just gonna close it and move to the next one. So make sure that your first project or case study is your strongest one and you're being super clear about it on that one before showing too many things. I'm not saying you should remove the rest, just make sure that the first few are the most important ones. So I'm gonna open the first project here. So right off the back, I get kind of like hero images about this project. I'm not sure exactly what I'm looking at right now. I love this photo, exactly not sure again, but how it's related to this project. And then we have a hero image here. To be honest, kind of feels like a wireframe, right? Like you have like missing things and like placeholders here and there. So if this was kind of like a hero image of your final project, I would expect a little more polished stuff, but that's okay. We'll get there in a sec. So we'll start with automotive inspection application, increasing efficiency and saving trees. Okay, this is pretty cool. So we start with an overview. Instead of an overview, you have a problem and you roll timeline tools. I think it's nice to start call it with an introduction to your project. That being said, I know I'm kind of like scrolling a little too fast, but I feel like a lot of designers, what we end up doing is we end up highlighting or having a header for, I guess, the different areas that we want to talk about. For example, we say problem, then we spend all this text defining the problem, my role, my approach, my contributions. In reality, when a recruiter is going to go through your portfolio or design manager, they're only going to read your headers. If they have the time or your portfolio already went through some rounds of approvals, maybe someone at the end actually gonna read like the whole thing or if they find it interesting. But in reality, you're probably just gonna scroll through it and see like, oh, there's a problem. There's an approach here. There's a contributions, research plan, great. But to me, reading those headers, they're not actually telling me a story. they're actually telling me that you know the steps and kind of you went to school and you read the books, but it's not telling me anything specific about this project. And it's great to know that you know the steps, don't get me wrong. Like I appreciate that when I'm hiring someone, but at the same time, when I'm reading your case study, I want to get an exciting story. I want to get excited about what you're trying to solve. And so a good tip for doing that has worked for me in the past is instead of saying the problem here, just replace this with a short sentence about the problem, right? So say something like, I'm just reading key application. The application is old from the early 2000s and lacked focus and user problems for accessibility. So just start with that. And I think like that's way more interesting. And if I find that interesting, I'll do a deeper dive in reading the rest of the problem. But if I just see the problem here, I may just keep the rest because it's just too much text and I don't have the time to read it, if that makes sense. So that would be like my first reaction to this. Again, same with the approach. I would try to recommend like just replacing these with short sentences in general. And a good test of doing this is, let's say you do that and you replace all of these headers with a short sentence, just put it in front of someone, let's say a friend or a family member, and see if they can get the story just by reading the headers. If they do, that's a good sign. So it means that recruiters are gonna be able to pick it up really quickly and probably gonna be moved to the next step. If they don't, it means that people are getting confused with your case study and they may be stuck. Just moving along because I know I don't have that much time, but when I see these kind of diagrams for your approach, for one side, I appreciate it. In the other side, it feels a little too generic. Like it feels like this could be applied to any project and that's okay. I know it's talking about your approach, but you're currently in this case study. So I want to know what was the approach for this particular project and why you decided to choose this route and what about this approach didn't go well or what went excellent and why you decided to go this route. So same would be with the research, right? Like probably a lot of these could be applied to any project. So I would be curious to know like why you decided to use it for this project and what do you learn from it? I have like a few more minutes, but moving along, I appreciate you have sketches as well. My question to these would be, did you added this just for your portfolio or did you found this really useful throughout your process? And if so, why and what do you learn from them? So I feel like a lot of people do this and I've done this as well, like just have sketches, low fidelity prototypes, high fidelity mocks, and then prototypes, kind of like what they teach us to do by the book. But in reality, every project's a little bit different. Sometimes you start with sketches, but then you just go straight to prototypes and then go back to sketches and so on because you learned something along the way and you wanted to fix it or iterate and find a new solution. So that's what I'm looking for rather than the actual steps. You have something out here about the challenge and then at the end, prototyping and then final design. As you can see here, I'm kind of going through portfolio pretty quickly. That's pretty much as much time anyone's going to spend on it. So again, make sure that your story is properly conveyed. I see these are your final designs. To me, they still feel like wireframes. Maybe that's okay. I would just love to know why. Like if this is what you're going for and this is what your company is shipping, I would like to understand why you chose that. Or if this is more like a final step of this case study and then you're looking to move it to the next one. So maybe this is just not finished yet. And then you have something else coming. One more quick thing before I passing on to my next, to Farai to take someone else. I quickly open this project and then, let me go back. This one here, which is your second one. And then I realized like you have like the same kind of diagrams on all of them, right? So if this is kind of your approach and the way you approach research, I would kind of move it out of the case study and just talk about yourself and the, how you look at solving these problems. But for the case study itself, I would rather just you talking about the story you're trying to tell me for that particular case study and why you follow that path for that reason. Cool. I'm gonna pause now and let Farai take the next one. Hope this was helpful, Thomas and everyone.
Cool, awesome. Thanks. So I'm gonna pick one, let me see here. And then do the sharing of the screen. Just a 1, 2, 3. Oh, I've done that silly thing where Zoom is going to need to kick me out before I can do this thing. Would you all be cool to bear with me for 30 seconds while I reboot and get back on? I'm really sorry about that. I should have set this up. I got a new laptop yesterday, so it's never shared before. I'll be back in a minute.
No problem. So if Lily or Nicolas wants to just chat about some general tips, this would be a perfect opportunity to do that.
For sure. I think that the insight that Nicolas said about the headers is so, so important. The moment he said it in my head, I was like, so true, so, so true. Recruiters really do just read headers, and reading that alone should really tell the story of your project. One thing I will add on top of that is that I noticed Tomas included a list of the tools that he used for this project, and tools are also certainly something that recruiters love to keyword on, just because recruiters don't really come from a design background themselves, and so they may not be necessarily super familiar with how to assess the quality of the work. Obviously it depends on the recruiter. I don't mean it in any sort of insult, but listing the tools is certainly a great way for them to understand, at the very least, do you match the qualifications of this job? You know, they know what the tools they use on the team. They know that the team might typically lean towards using Sketch or Adobe After Effects for motion, like whatever those are. Obviously, tools are a little bit flexible. You know, if you know one, you can always learn another one. But if you already know the tool that the team is using, it's a plus one for you.
Yeah, another thing that I would say, following up on the headers insight, is think about your case study as a story you're trying to tell someone, like a movie or a short book. Like, you're trying to convey a story to someone about what's a problem you found or you were put on, and why, how you tackle that problem, what you learn from it, and what your process to finding it. And try to get people excited as they're reading it. Like, it's just a story. Like, they want to say, like, wow, this is amazing. I want to learn more about this person, and I want to actually get to know them and maybe even work with them. So that's what you're looking for. Like, it's great that you're showing that you know the steps and you know wireframes, prototyping, and all that stuff. Yes, definitely thumbs up. But a lot of people know that. I want to know what made that project specifically exciting and what was the result and why.
Yeah, and I think one thing as I'm scrolling for another portfolio to get myself ready for my turn is that I'm seeing some are password protected. And so I completely understand that there are certainly cases where your work is under NDA and you can't share it publicly. One thing that I will certainly advise is that show as much as you can. Obviously, learn where that boundary is, talk with your former or current employer about what that line is, but really try to show as much as you can, even if it's just a bio about you. Obviously, your background, that of course is yours to show. And then for the project itself, are you able to say it's a web design versus mobile design? Are you able to say that it's in the finance industry versus another industry, you know, like just like grasp at straws at any sort of detail to be able to offer, just because even if it's very little, it's better than nothing. There's nothing worse than being faced with absolutely zero detail about your work and then have to make the decision on, did I get enough signal about this person right now to reach out and basically follow up to learn more about them? So give them every reason for them to do that.
These are great tips, Lily. Thanks so much. So Lily, why don't you pick up the next person? We're just going to grant sharing access to Farai. So after you, then Farai would start. So you go ahead.
Done.
Farai, you are all up.
All right, cool. Fantastic. Yeah. Let me give it a shot.
No problem.
Okay. Cool. I am trusting that y'all can see a portfolio now. Cool, fantastic. Sorry for the delay there. So this is Hiral Parekh's portfolio. So as is typical of portfolios of 2020, there is this story at the beginning, kind of introducing the person. I'm going to go on a slight rant about this. In that, one of the things I find about these is that I guess it's important for me to know who you are as a hiring manager. I guess there are different processes, as Nicolas and Lily have highlighted, and different people who will be looking at your portfolio. But one of the things that I think these stories don't typically kind of include is the perspective of me as the hiring manager and what I'm looking for. So again, I think some have highlighted what cities they're in and what they're doing and all those things. But I just want to show you this example of this portfolio of a dude called Jorge Arango. So he has written some books about information architecture and so on and so forth. What's interesting is he does have a sentence that talks about Jorge, but before he talks about himself, he talks about me and what I need, right? And this is an important thing. It's a slightly different context. It's cool for you to introduce yourself and what you got to bring to the party, but understanding what my problem is as a hiring manager, or the problem that that role specifies, the role wants somebody who is, you know, whether the role wants someone who's a storyteller, who's got logic reasoning, is that specific to me? That's something worth thinking about, and specific, and making it specific to me, I don't mean specific to Farai, but at least specific to the job roles that you want to go for, as Nicolas highlighted. So this sentence, I think, you know, everyone has got this, but just make sure that in it, you kind of also think about what I'm looking for, and that you kind of gear that towards me. So that's something that's worth considering. The other thing I think with this portfolio is that with storytelling and logic reasoning, this kind of sets me up to expect to see these things within the portfolio. So this person is saying that these are their key skills. Are they going to be able to show me that, you know, as I go through? That's going to be an interesting thing. Looking at the navigation up here, there is something about a thesis. So maybe the person is a student. That's interesting. And then this fun thing is something that I might want to look at as well to see what that looks like. So there's something different there that's quite cool to see as I kind of have a look at this portfolio. So this first one, memes as political discourse, Snapchat AR, memes as political discourse. I don't have a clear understanding of what that might be, but it looks interesting. So placemaking week, website redesign. So what's great about what this person has done in their portfolio is they've kind of told me what kind of work this is. Some portfolios will just have a screenshot and I'm not clear what kind of work I'm looking for, or they'll just have the name of the company or the name of the project that they did it on. And so this is kind of good because it kind of gives me an idea of what I'm looking at here. In terms of showing the skills that are showcased within here, what this might be helpful for, as the other reviewers have mentioned already, the hiring manager is typically time poor. And so when you can kind of give them an idea of what you've got to offer and which portfolio is going to showcase which skills, that can be helpful in terms of being able to allow me to decide, okay, cool, I can see the things I'm looking for. Am I looking for mobile? Am I looking for, you know, accessibility or whatever it is? That's kind of written up front. And again, it's the job, right? Redesigning the education experience. So this person has done a good job of giving me an idea of what I can expect on the other side of everything. So there's a lot of detail here that is, you know, not showing off the entire portfolio, but it's giving me a good idea of what's going on at the end. That looks scary and interesting. So I might look at that as well, the fighting, the tarantula thing, but that's only if I scroll all the way to the bottom. So randomly, I'm just going to pick this one here, which is the redesigning the education experience for children with blindness. So there's this large thing now. So there's an animated hero image here. Okay, the overview education, which sounds a bit like it's repeating what's been set up here. And then there's some detail about the project. There's the role tools that we used and the timeline. So these are some, timeline is something that Lily mentioned, which is great to see here, which is like, give me an idea of when you did this, right? Is this work that you did in 2000 or it's closer to 2020? It's good to kind of get a view of that. It's a challenge. Envision yourself as a user with disability. Okay. So here, this challenge is kind of ambiguous. I guess, was this the challenge for the team, the challenge for the project, or is this just the challenge that I faced as a designer in trying to get to understand this? Also, I'd say that this stacking of two different headings, I guess maybe it tries to do the telling of the story that Nicolas mentioned, which I think you're doing here by having kind of these more detailed headings. But I feel like the double headers are maybe not as necessary. You could maybe structure this in a way that kind of simplifies the way this is laid out. And so we wanted to use technology to 3 touch points, the tablet. Okay, cool. So again, I'll be skimming this. And as I'm looking at this, I'm looking at the headings underneath. And the labels, the captions for these images are telling me, they might be very accurate in telling me what I'm looking at. But what I don't understand is why this is here. Am I understanding that this is, you know, so maybe if this said touch point 1, 2, 3, again, if we think about the fact that the hiring manager might be time poor, it might be cool to kind of explain what each image brings. And I would say this is important across the portfolios. It's been mentioned by the other reviewers as well, that if you're putting something on as, you know, putting a graphic up, make sure that it's part of the story. That if I scroll and only ever see the graphics, I can get an idea of either you're showing me your process or you're showing me the final product. But captions next to your images are really, really important. One, for accessibility, it's just great practice. But secondly, I think also just thinking about how this contributes to the story that I'm supposed to take away from the work. And again, I think thinking about this is a portfolio where the owner of the portfolio was talking about storytelling at the beginning. And so these are the kinds of things, you know, storytelling is, again, in presenting your work. So when this can be more of a story, this is great. And I think the large headings do an attempt to kind of to showcase that. So we're looking at the context, the goal, the user group, and the stages of awareness. So this is the context of the problem that they were trying to solve and where it was. These were the stages, and this is the user journey. So in showing artifacts of any kind that are giving me an idea of the process that the team went through or that the individual went through, for me, I'm interested not in knowing whether or not you know that this is the kind of thing I expect to see on a portfolio, but I'm more interested in how did we get to this user's journey that you're showing me, right? Was it your solo work or was this the work of the team that kind of came together to do this? Maybe even a time scale, like how long did it take us to get to this point? The kinds of iterations that we might have gone in. And then lastly, to understand what did this journey contribute to the project, right? So did this help the engineering team to understand something? Did this help tie together the marketing efforts with the goals that we had or whatever it is? Like those are all important things to know, because I guess it's easy to put artifacts into your portfolio. What's harder is to help somebody to understand whether you know why those things needed to be part of the project and the value that they generated. That's really critical. That's the kind of thing that I'm trying to understand is, do you know why this thing exists and, you know, why I might need this in my team and in my organization? So this is cool. We're seeing some sketches here. I'm a big fan of sketches. I prefer to see sketches, more sketches, simply because rather than telling me that you know a process, by showing me the artifacts that you created, I get an idea that, okay, cool, you're showing me the evidence of the kind of thing that you might do. And I might look at these and try and tie these up with the image of the final product that you have to share to get an idea of, okay, so this person has an idea of how this works. And again, you know, the sketching, was this solo sketching? Did we do this together? Did this come out of a design sprint? Like, this is great context to share here to kind of explain to me where these sketches came from. Okay. I think this user flow might be a little under detailed, but maybe I'm focusing a bit too much here. Wireframing. So I made wireframes to decide on the basic look and user flow of the tablet. The prototype helped understanding the functioning of the tablet, right? So this starts to try and explain why this user flow was created, but I think even more detail would be great. Also, the legibility isn't fantastic here. So this, the choice of type, the choice of color, all of those things make this difficult for me to actually see the detail. And again, I think Nicolas mentioned this before, and Lily may have as well, which is if you're going to put some of these artifacts on, like allow me to see them. So I'm going to try click this. Okay, cool. Fantastic. Then I can actually zoom in and look at the detail of what this is trying to say. Okay, so this is giving me an idea of what is the overall journey from waking up the screen to somebody being able to input a message. Okay, so that gives me an idea of what goes on, which is cool. So these are the low fidelity prototypes. All right. Again, here, it's good to know that we created low fidelity prototypes. What did we do with them? What did we do with the wireframes and the user journeys, right? So what is the value that, because ultimately, as a hiring manager, I'm like, cool. So if I'm going to allow you to spend a week, 2 weeks, or whatever it is working on this, can I be sure that you know what value you're going to bring to the organization by doing this work? I think that's the overall thing. And then we've got the final design here. This looks slightly misleading. I'm not sure what, I guess this is the final tablet high fidelity prototype, but it doesn't look like the final design of the thing itself. So that might be something that I might look at and question and try to understand, like, what does this actually mean when we're looking at this here? Then the smart reading table. Okay, so this is for the table and the final design. Cool, gotcha. And then the space. So these sketches are quite cool, but they're quite light as well. So that's kind of a, let me wrap up, because I think we're gonna run out of time. But so for me, those are some key things, thinking about it to add to what other folks have already spoken about. Like that first sentence, talk about me, talk about you. If you're putting artifacts in your portfolio, make sure they add value and that you show that you understand why we should be spending time on this when we're working on a project, because that helps to highlight your process. And then absolutely, the story matters. So make sure that you're structuring a story in the layout that you present and the headings that you use. So that's me for now, but thanks very much. And thank you, Hiral Parekh, for sharing your work.
Thanks, Farai. So we have about 10 minutes left. So request to all the three mentors. The next round, we will try to pick up three projects and we're going to do it at a really fire round. So under 3 minutes or less. All right, I see Kieran dancing. All right, Kieran, 3 minutes or less.
All right, I will try my best. All right, I have picked Tiffany. And the reason why I did pick her is because as I was scrolling through, I noticed that there is a case study on Messenger, and as someone who works on Messenger, highly curious on what this is. So 3 minutes, okay. Pin items in Messenger, great. I understand exactly what that means. Maybe it's because I'm in Messenger. Hopefully that makes sense to everybody. Great that you have product shots up front. Again, very necessary to explain what this is doing. Very clear paragraph with what this is, what it's doing, and your goal. That's awesome. Love the breakdown of roles, tools, and timeline. 3 weeks is a very short amount of time, so already very impressed at the fidelity that you were able to achieve. Problem statement, also great research. Do that header thing where you replace this with the actual goals that you decided to hone in on. I'm not gonna read into it. I only have 3 minutes. Okay, so this is going into some of the research. I'm assuming that this was derived from, derived from user interviews. Great, this is an affinity map. That's very helpful for me to know. So this is excellent. This is basically the high level pain points that you have observed. And again, reiterated here, that's awesome. Straight into problem. Problem again. I'm wondering why it's repeated here. Two problem statements, but I don't have enough time to dive into why. Brainstorm. I know that brainstorm is something that a lot of people include in their portfolios. Personally, for me, brainstorming isn't something that's very valuable for me to learn about as part of the project, just because brainstorming sessions are, relatively common across all types of projects, not unique to just this one. I do appreciate the opportunity to have an insight into the different ideas that you propose and some of the strengths and weaknesses. So that is very, very nice to be able to see into, but as a whole, brainstorming, usually keep it to as minimum as possible. I think that if you had said brainstorm and then included this graphic, that probably would have been enough. I don't think I needed anything else. Oh, well, I do appreciate the impact versus feasibility, but still try to minimize here. Straight into solution. Great. Again, awesome that you have a video. Really makes it easy to imagine the end product. I love the header of exactly what problem you're solving here. That's great. You're dissecting it into the different features. but that is Slack. So I'm wondering what Slack is doing in your solution section. Interesting. Sketches are, in my personal opinion, not the best way to convey an idea, especially in your portfolio. I would start from mid-fi and go up from there. There's your mid-fi or hi-fi. That's great. And then straight to your final. Again, same advice as the last portfolio I did. Really select an important workflow here, and really try to lead me through some of the decisions that went into making that decision. You know, given this exact same screen, what were the different options that you took a look at? What were the pros and cons of each of them? And why did you ultimately decide screen C to be your final product? I want to see that. But overall, I'm able to tell that you have excellent visual design skills, excellent interaction motion skills, certainly a level of product thinking involved here. So overall, a very, very rounded out designer. 3 minutes.
That was really quick. Yeah. Awesome job, Lily. All right, Nicolas, 3 minutes for you. It's almost like speed dating.
Right. Okay, so I have Brooke's portfolio here. So right off the bat, I get this, it's great to meet you. I guess it's great to meet you too. I wonder if that's the most important thing you want to highlight, but maybe it is, not sure. I'm Brooke, product designer based in California. I love making pretty websites, trying new recipes and searching for a best hot sauce. Well, just reading this, I'm a little confused already. First, I mean, I say you're a product designer. That's awesome. But you also say that you love making pretty websites. So to me, this starts to feel more like a visual design portfolio, right? That a product design one, or maybe, there's a little confusion there. And then you talk a little bit about cooking, which is great. That's adds a little more flavor to who you are. But just I'm got a little confused about exactly what I'm looking for. And quick feedback here would be, if you're looking for a product design role, make sure, or a UX role, make sure you're conveying that story at your portfolio. If you're looking more for a visual design role, likewise, make sure you're telling the right story as well. This is good. Looking for remote LA-based work. I don't know if you need to have this in the like on your landing page or your portfolio. It can be up to you. That's super important that you want to convey it right away, sure. But I feel like depending on the role and the company, you maybe will talk about that. So I'm just gonna, I have like 1 minute, so I'm just gonna move to the first case study really quickly. So I see here you have Cookshelf mobile app design. There's quick background here, can jump straight to the prototype. I've seen this quite a lot. I don't know if I love that, because I wanna get the story first. I wanna see why you got there before going to the final design. Just seeing the final design doesn't tell me the full story about how you got there and why you chose to follow that route. So I would keep that in mind, but again, interesting approach. You have an objective, product duration, 2 weeks. It's pretty quickly, like the previous portfolio Lily was showing us. That's pretty fast. Interesting about your tools. Quick thought about tools in general. Tools in product design or UX design are quickly changing. Every day we get new tools and older ones just disappear. So I would rather see that you're flexible about being able to pick up new tools and you're not attached to tools at all, even though it's good to see that you use this for this particular project. Just 1 more minute. Appreciate having a hero image here. Doesn't tell me much, but talks a little bit about you being able to create high fidelity mocks and that kind of stuff. And then the other thing that comes into mind right away is you start talking about your research first, but I don't know if I know the problem quite yet. So you start talking about interviews, but what am I trying to solve first? I think you talk here a little bit about how people cook and recipes in the kitchen, but I would love to see just a header about, hey, this is a problem. And now I'm jumping into user interviews. So yeah, that's kind of quick reaction. Market research and benchmark analysis. This is awesome that you did it, but this is really overwhelming. I don't know if anyone's going to read this. It's quite a bit to have it in front of you. And yeah, I guess I'm just gonna stop to let Farai have 2 more minutes to go to the last one, but hope that was helpful.
Awesome, thanks, Nicolas. All right, Farai, I will give you another additional minute, so you've got 3 minutes, all right? So take your time. Farai, you're muted.
Rookie era, wasting my own time. Cool. So what I like about this and the reason I picked it, personality, right? And the personality is coming from the choice of typeface here and the showing of the kind of the illustration of the person themselves. And the layout is slightly different from what we see a lot. So this kind of makes me want to pay more attention to, and just, I'll remember this, for example. I think these screenshots could maybe afford to be bigger. Not that I would look on at everything on such a huge screen right now. Let me zoom in a little bit. But I do appreciate that. And there's three case studies that they've highlighted, 1, 2, 3, which is a great number. For me, if I don't feel overwhelmed if I need to look at their work. And testimonials is an interesting one, which is kind of like, you know, who else have you worked with? What did they want to say? What did they say about you? At the bottom here, again, more personality. And then it says, call me, beep me if you want to reach me. Again, this person, like, they write the way they speak. This feels natural. And I think this is a great example of somebody using just the words and a bit of the way they lay out their portfolio to kind of give us an idea of the kind of person that they are, which I think is great. And it stands out. Again, if I go into some of this detail, you see more of that quirkiness coming through in what they do. We've spoken about process before, and I guess they're talking about the research. Again, here, what you've got is a diagram that looks quite small, but I guess you can go into a bit more detail to kind of understand it. And the headings they use, so define, synthesis, meet Emily. So this doesn't say personas, it says meet Emily. And that's a different way of kind of just trying to tell the story of what's going on here. Brainstorming, Lily spoke about before, some lo-fi work. Is it the icons, I guess, that they were looking at here? They show some mid-fi. I can kind of zoom into that and get more detail, which is pretty cool. More with less, found on home, mixing it up. You know, the language that this person is using, feedback. I think that's the whole main thing that I want to pull out from this is just using the way you write, the way you speak to kind of show your personality while also showcasing your work. The balance of words to pictures as well here seems quite nice. There's no huge paragraphs. I prefer maybe some larger images, but definitely it just doesn't feel like excessively wordy. And I can take a lot of detail from what they have to share. But I'm going to stop there.
Awesome. Can I say something before? Oh, oops, you already stopped sharing.
Sure.
I was about to say that portfolio is doing an excellent job of showing iterations, like I mentioned before. I know that's right. Only showing before and after, but it's really pointing to the part of the screen that they're iterating on. And there was even a bullet list of the type of trade-offs that they considered. That is exactly what I was looking for in terms of that iteration thing I was talking about.
Thanks for adding that.
Yeah, amazing. All right, that's it, everyone. This is all the time we have for today. But as promised, if you have any burning questions, now is the time. Does anyone here have a question or comment for the mentors? Please go ahead and unmute yourself and ask your question directly. Anybody?
Hello.
Hi. Go for it.
Hi, everyone. It's a great session. So what would you advise someone? So I have two points, like two questions combined in one question. So I have been currently in the service industry for, you know, past three, four years. Basically, I am working on freelance basis or with agencies. But I now completely want to move into a product-based company where I can devote more into research and advocate the users. So first thing is that. Another is I have mostly worked for enterprise products and, you know, in B2B domain and in a SaaS domain. So, and that's where I want to go in the future as well. So if you have any advice for, you know, these two or one of the two points, if you would.
I'm not sure if I fully understood your question, Lily. You got it?
No, I was about to say, I didn't catch all that either. And I was wondering if anyone could paraphrase.
Okay. Okay. So let me rephrase this. So basically I have designed like my most of the work in enterprise and B2B domain where they don't, either they don't even have budget or time for very much visual thing. So my current projects on my portfolio looks very low in terms of visuals, but they are high in terms of UX and the feature building and flow easing thing for their enterprise users. So and we don't get to show everything that we do for some company on a B2B level or enterprise level. There are some constraints, and it's not a public work because they are not a consumer products. So all these things gets into the path to showcase my work or showcase my skill. So even though I have a great visual skill, somehow I didn't do it, or somehow the project was not requiring it at that point of time. So I haven't done that. So how to cope up with that?
I can probably take that one.
Oh, sorry. No, please, you go ahead.
Okay. I work in the B2B industry. Okta is an enterprise company. My quick two thoughts would be, yes, there's a lot of projects that they don't require a final like high quality visual design, but in my opinion, my experience, sometimes that doesn't really matter. It's more about the process of how you got there and the solution you're proposing. And if that solution is red, yellow, blue, or big, small, whatever, it doesn't really matter as long as you're telling a good story about how you find the solution. And then the second part of it is, if visual design is something that you're really passionate about and you want to convey it in your portfolio, use the rest of your portfolio to tell the story. Like, you can have a beautiful design portfolio that is super accessible and is pretty clear to use. And then the use cases more are tailored toward B2B or enterprise, if that makes sense. So don't worry about having visual design final products on all your projects. Worry more about the process.
Yeah, so I also want to go deeper into UX and research only, not the visual part of it. But the thing I'm getting rejected from companies is that you haven't done great visuals, or you are not that those kind of comments I'm getting. So if I'm applying to wrong companies, or is that seriously something that I'm lacking right now? So I'm confused between those two things.
All right, Meet. So we're going to move on to another question. We will definitely have a post on our ADP list LinkedIn page about it. So perhaps we can take the conversation there. One question is from Sophie Kreitman. Sorry if I'm butchering your last name. I think it's very popular. A lot of people are talking about it. I have a question is regarding transitioning from architecture to product design. How do you suggest to sell my previous experience? I feel it's very relevant, but so far in my job search, it has been overlooked. Anybody?
I assume that goes also to me. Or you want to take it?
Sure. No, go ahead. You were an architect before in a previous life, I think?
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead.
I can give my opinion, then you can go ahead. I was an architect as well. And just to go straight to the point of your question is, when you're applying, I guess my experience at the beginning when I was applying for UX design jobs, I used to have everything in my portfolio, like architecture, UX design, visual design, everything that I come up with. And that was a little confusing for recruiters. So what I would do is focus on the role you're trying to get and your experience that you learn as a UX designer, and then have at the end or somewhere in your portfolio a little bit of your background. So I would love to see like, okay, you're the perfect person for this role. You definitely know what you're looking for, what I'm looking for a UX designer. Add on top of that, you have all of this amazing background and all of this amazing design thinking you've done in a different role. So you're just adding like the tip of the ice to your portfolio, if that makes sense. But make sure your portfolio is focused and tailored to the role or the path you're trying to follow.
Yeah, I'd absolutely echo that. I'd also highlight that to anyone transitioning from any trade, like a whole bunch of people in UX didn't start studying UX, right? They've come from many different places. That's just the fact about the industry and the nature of the work that we do and its maturity. But a great way to think about your previous experience is to try and tell a story. Like in my mind, when you spoke about architecture, the first thing I thought about was if I had a part of my website that said something like, what are the similarities between architecture and user experience design? Now that's too blatant and you need to find a way to kind of craft that really well, but to be able to draw links between your previous job and your current job, you actually have to show that you know a lot about user experience design right now. And that in itself is telling me something about you. So that's, you know, that's a way that you can use that, so that it's not necessarily that I'm interested in, not that I'm not interested, but I'm not hiring you for your architecture, but I'm hiring you for the fact that you see the connection between what you used to do and what you're trying to do and what you would like to do if you were to join my team.
Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. Lily, go for it. You want some parting thoughts?
No, I was about to say, I saw someone else ask the same question regarding transitioning from computer science. And if I can just add some closing thoughts there. I think that plus one on obviously both Nicolas and Farai's point, but in case you wanted to steal my answer for, because I come from a computer science background, you know, I basically broke it down into soft skills and hard skills. Obviously hard skill programming is a little bit less transferable sometimes, but you can always, depending on the company that you're applying to, maybe it's a startup, they will especially appreciate the ability for you to jump in the backlog and start coding right away and help your engineers. And then soft skill wise, I always say I'm able to communicate with engineers very effectively as a result of my background. And so those are answers you can definitely steal.
All right. Thanks, everybody, for tuning in. We have something very, very exciting for our next event. So please welcome my partner in crime, Winona, to tell us more about it.
Yeah. So on Wednesday, August 19th, 9 p.m. Eastern time, we have our next After Hours, the Uncensored Edition, featuring the very well-known Chris Doe. For those of you who haven't heard of Chris Doe, he is a designer, director, educator, as well as the CEO and founder of The Future. The Future has more than 880,000 subscribers on YouTube, and they're on a 1 billion mission to teaching people how to make a living doing what they love. We also have a very special live music performance by a Toronto-based duo, Baobab Cherry, featuring Donay Roberts and Yukiko Tsutsui. We will be releasing more details of the event in the next few days, so stay tuned on our LinkedIn. Back to Trids.
Thanks, Winona. Really looking forward to that episode. So now I'm going to take our popular selfie or screenshots, if you will, and you guys know the drill. Come close to the camera, set your hair, and get ready to bedazzle everyone with a big smile. All right, in 3, 2, 1. Amazing. I've got 6 pages. I'm going to do this really quick. In 3, 2, 1. Beautiful. The third page. Sorry. I see people already laughing at me. That's perfectly all right. All right, in 3, 2, 1. Mazel tov to that. Okay, fourth page now. Real quick, 3, 2, 1. All right, the fifth one. In 3, 2, 1. And finally, the last page. Let's do this real quick. In 3, 2, 1. Perfect. All right. Thanks, guys. That is it for today. A big shout out to Lily, Nicolas, and Farai for joining us. And a bigger, much bigger shout out to all my design friends here on this call. I know it's a tough time right now. The political climate is suffocating. The economy is not the best. But I'm telling you, the possibilities for you are endless. There are so many different and great things and amazing things you can do. Only if you believe in yourself and open yourself to all possibilities. If you would like to share this episode with a friend or simply watch it again, please feel free to do so on our YouTube channel of Amazing Design People List. As always, you will find all our past episodes there. Goodbye, everyone, and hope to see you in 2 weeks. Guest mentors and ADP List team, please stay back on this call for a quick debrief. Bye, everyone.
I know it's not something to ignore. You take me for a fool. You take me for